Good evening. I want to welcome you, each one of you that have come this evening right before the Sabbath. It's been a beautiful, beautiful day, and we're happy to have the Bullards here, Becky and Jim. They're from Central California. He used to teach Bible Academy in Bakersfield, California. And I think that's something that I've just learned. It's really special. He has a master's in outdoor education. And what that means, I want him to explain more, because it sounds very interesting. They've been traveling for some, I think, almost a month now. Yeah, but I have to say that I think we had a little bit of an invitation for them to come our way. They have some family that they're staying with while they're here in Hayden that live close by. And then they're going to, after they finish on Monday, they're headed out towards Portland area where they have a daughter. So we are very thankful for them to come and share about end-time faith and end-time wilderness survival. We are looking forward to learning and studying God's Word. Can we bow our heads before I have Jim come up? Loving Father in heaven, we want to be ready for when our names come up in judgment, ready for the final movements of earth. And help us to have hearts to reach out to those that do not know you and connect us with those that are interested. May we live for the honor and glory of God. I thank you. Amen. Amen. Thank you for coming, Jim.
You're welcome. Like Lorraine said, we're glad to be here. We get to see some family we haven't seen for a while. Becky, stand up or just wave or something like that. There's Becky there in case you missed her. You'll see more of her tomorrow. Our ministry is called Preparing to Stand, based on a couple Ellen White quotes that are based on the question at the end of Revelation 6. You know, the great day of his wrath has come, and who shall be able to stand? Well, God does want a people standing then. And what these quotes say is, like, basically our work, or in God, one says it's our work, and the other one says God is calling for men and women who will prepare a people to stand. And so that's our job. And that's what we're naming our ministry after. There's four main facets to that ministry. The first one is practical Christianity, which is a lot of what we'll be talking about tonight. End time prophecy study is the second one. That's what we're going to deal with tomorrow. Country living, especially for the no buy, no sell time. We'll be talking about that on Sunday. And then wilderness survival for our final flight just before Jesus comes. And that's going to be the main topic on Monday. So, they're passing out study guides. If you don't have one and want one, please raise your hand and they'll come bring you one. We found that some people like the study guides. A lot of people do. There's some people that don't like them. Do what works for you. You're not going to be graded on any of this. if it's helpful, fine. If it's not helpful, don't worry about it. Just sit and listen. That's fine. It's not going to hurt my feelings one way or the other. The main reason I'm passing these out is I am hoping you will share this information. I'm only one person. I can't get everywhere. And this message needs to get out. And so if you choose to share this and trying to remember what we talked about. Well, you got an outline right there in front of you by filling the study guide out. Also attached to the study guide is a quotation sheet. That has the various quotations we'll be looking at. Wanted to get those into your hands. So even if you don't fill out the study guide, please do make use of the quotation sheet. Okay, let me get my study guide out so I can follow along and not get everybody all tangled up like I manage to do sometimes. Let's turn now to John 14, verse 26. John 14:26. And as you're turning, I'm just going to let you know my spiritual gift is teaching. I'm not here to preach at you. I think you'll figure out real quickly what that means. One of my goals is to have you interact with the Word as much as possible. So rather than actually reading it, I'm assuming all of you have that. I see most of you looking down and turning pages, so that's good. I'm just going to ask a question about this verse. John 14, verse 26. What's the promise there? What's the promise? That the Holy Spirit will do what? Teach us all things. Okay, I have found this to be literally true. This isn't limited to just spiritual stuff. Most of the other things we'll be sharing with you this weekend, I haven't had anybody teach me yet, other than the Holy Spirit directing my life so that I would encounter this information and package it up for you. So the question that I have next is, how many of you want the Holy Spirit to teach us this evening? Amen. Hope you didn't just come to listen to me. Okay, you can actually plug into being taught by the Holy Spirit. Now, if we want the Holy Spirit to teach us, notice what the first quotation says. So flip your page over and look at quotation number one. It's from Review and Herald, March 22, 1887. It says, there is nothing Satan fears so much. You want to make Satan afraid? Here we go. There's nothing that Satan fears so much as that the people of God shall do what? Clear the way. And how do we clear the way? By removing every hindrance so that the Lord can pour out His Spirit. So if we want the Holy Spirit, what do we need to do? Clear the way. And how do we clear the way? By removing every hindrance. Is there anything standing between you and God right now? Okay, group this size. I'm sure there's all sorts of possibilities. I would just invite you as we pray to claim this promise that the Holy Spirit will be sent, that you be willing to clear the way. If there's anything standing between you and God, be willing to set it aside, at least for the time that we're here together, so that God can pour out His Spirit. We can recognize His voice speaking to us and be blessed by it. Okay? So let's pray. Father, thank You. You haven't left us alone. Promise to send Your Holy Spirit to teach us all things. So we claim that promise here right now. And if there's anything standing between You and us, may we be willing to set it aside, so that You can have free access to our hearts and minds, and we can recognize Your voice and be blessed by it. I pray in Jesus' name, amen. Let's look at the next two quotations. First one's from Testimonies of the Church, Volume 5, page 714, 715. Says, the peculiar work of who? The third angel has not been seen in its importance. Okay, let's look at the next quote. I'm going to treat both of these together here. It's from Testimonies of Church, Volume 9, page 19. It says, in a special sense, Seventh-day Adventists have been set in the world as watchmen and light bearers. To them has been entrusted the last warning for a perishing world. On them is shining wonderful light from the Word of God. They have been given a work of the most solemn import. And what's that work? Okay, the proclamation of the first, second, and third angel's message. Messages. There is no other work of so great importance. They are to allow nothing else to absorb their attention. Several years ago, I kept running across quotations like this. Actually, I think God arranged it all. And I thought, okay, third angel's message is important. You know, Adventists make a big deal out of the three angels' messages. I have that symbolized somewhere almost on all of our logos and everything. And I just remember being, you know, running across these quotations and being impressed, you know, well, maybe there's something more to the three angels' messages than what I understand, because I thought I knew them, what they were all about. So I went to Revelation 14 and read through them. And the first angel's message is a proclamation that the judgment hour has begun. Okay, the hour of his judgment has come. I'm like, okay, I understand that, you know, whole 1844 thing. Second angel's message, declaration that Babylon has fallen, you know, that false religious system that it stands for. Like, okay, I understand that. Third angel's message is basically a warning against receiving the mark of the beast. Well, I understand what that's all about, and I'm not going to do that. You know, let's go on to something more interesting. But God kept sending me these quotations. And finally I realized that, you know, there had to be something more than what I thought I understood about these messages. And interestingly enough, about that same time, I'd been studying about William Miller and the Millerite movement. And, you know, William Miller started out as a deist. You know what a deist is? Seen a lot of confused looks. Okay, even people shaking their head. I didn't know either. A deist is somebody who believes that God created the world and the universe, but basically once he created it, he just went off and let it run its course. Okay, so deists believe in a creator God, but they don't believe in a very loving, personal, involved God. And that's how William Miller started out. A lot of people were deists back in the day, including some of the key, you know, founding fathers for America and all that stuff. A lot of them were deists. However, because of some things that happened to him, he started realizing, well, maybe there's more to Christianity than what I thought. And finally, he decided to study it out for himself. And so this is his study method. This is the main reason I'm sharing this whole story. Is he decided he was going to take his Bible, start with, and the concordance, and start with Genesis 1:1, and just start working his way through verse by verse, and let Scripture explain Scripture. And he was going to go into that process by setting aside all the preconceived opinions that he already had. And I thought, well, that sounds like a pretty good Bible study method to me. Maybe I ought to do that with the three angels' message. And so that's what I did. I'm going to set aside all my preconceived opinions because I thought I knew this stuff already. And just start studying them verse by verse and let Scripture explain Scripture. And that began what has been the most extensive and most interesting Bible study I have ever done. In fact, in one way or another, it's still continuing, even though I began this several years back. And one of the more recent things I've discovered I want to share with you this evening, and that is the next quotation, quotation number 4 from Letters and Manuscripts, volume 14. There's more information there if you need to look it up. And it says, there are how many? Two classes brought to view in the Word of God. And because of the context here, it calls them the wise and the foolish. And I'd just like you to think about all the different scriptures, you know, parables that Jesus gave, and the whole book of Proverbs for that matter. All of these are contrasting the wise and the foolish. And the interesting thing with this quote is I'd been thinking about a lot of the parables of Christ in particular, and realizing, you know, in each of these parables, there's two groups. You know, there's some parables that seem to have three groups or four groups, but it really gets down to just two groups at the very end of the story. And so I just kind of realizing, you know, there's these two groups. There's only two groups. You know, we like to make three or more sometimes, but there's really just the two. And then I ran across this quote, which like confirmed my suspicions that there was just the two groups. And what really got interesting is when I realized those same two groups are in the third angel's message. So let's turn there and look at them and how they're described. And see what we can learn. We'll turn to Revelation 14. Start with verse 9. Says, then a third angel followed, you have first and second ones, saying with a loud voice, if anyone worships the beast in his image and receives his mark on his forehead or on his hand, he himself shall also drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out full strength into the cup of his indignation. And he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of their torment ascends forever and ever, and they have no rest day or night who worship the beast in his image, and whoever receives the mark of his name. Verse 12, here's the patience of the saints. Here are those who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Okay, how are those two groups described here? What's the first group? Those who worship the beast and receive the mark. Okay, that's the next line on your study guide there. And what's the second group? Those who keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus. And so here we have these same two groups. And that seems all interesting and nice. Until we bring the parable of the 10 virgins into it. Matthew 25, 1 through 13, if you need to refresh your memory there. I think most of you are pretty familiar with that parable. It's probably one of the most well-known of the parables. Okay, here we have the wise and the foolish, the same two groups again. But let's note some things about the foolish. What did they have? They had their lamps. What do the lamps represent? God's word. So they had the word. Okay, here's foolish virgins. They have the word. And where are they heading? To meet the bridegroom and to the wedding. Okay, who's the bridegroom? Yeah, bridegroom represents Jesus. So if they're going to meet the bridegroom, they're expecting to meet Jesus when he comes and going to the wedding. What's the wedding represent? Entering into God's kingdom when Jesus comes. Okay, think about that. Here's some foolish virgins. And you know what happened to them in the end, but at the beginning, they've got the word and they're expecting Jesus to come and they're expecting to get into the kingdom. But where do they end up? Outside. With who? Those who have worshiped the beast and received the mark. And if we would have gone up to any of the foolish virgins before everything, you know, this separation happened and says, you know, you're going to end up with those who worship the beast and receive the mark. That means you're worshiping the beast and receiving the mark. And they're like, no way. That's not us. We've got the word. We're looking forward to Jesus coming. We're expecting to get into the kingdom. But there's only the two groups. Wise and the foolish, those who worship the beast and receive the mark, and those who keep the commandments and have the faith of Jesus. There's only the two groups. And so this lets me know that there's a bunch of us in the church who are deceived into thinking that we're going to get into the kingdom when actually we're worshiping the beast and going to receive the mark. So it's really important that we understand what it means to worship the beast. That's what I want to talk about next. What's the root word for worship? Go with the first three letters and add a TH. Worth, which has the idea of values. So what values does the beast have? What values does the beast stand for? And look at Revelation, I think we're still there, and at least I'm still there in Revelation 14. Flip over to chapter 13, verse 4. And those who worship the beast are also worshiping who? The dragon. And flip over one more chapter to chapter 12, verse 9. It tells you who the dragon is real clearly. Who's the dragon? Satan. So those who worship the beast are also worshiping Satan. So what values do Satan and the beast stand for? And we need to be careful that we're not embracing any of those values. Because if we're embracing those same values, that means we're actually worshiping the beast. Let's look at the next quote. It's the most concise place I have found these values expressed. Quotation number 5 from Christ Triumphant, page 289. It says, the rebellion against God's law was begun by Satan in heaven. So it's taken us way back to the beginning of all this. By this rebellion, sin was brought into existence. It's kind of an interesting thought. Satan insisted that God had not dealt with him how? Justly. Let's put that in other words.
Not fair.
Yeah, God isn't fair. That's what he's saying. God's not fair. Are we tempted to think God's not fair sometimes? When we read about or find out about something God wants us to do and we think, I can't do that. Aren't we saying God's not fair? Remember, all his biddings are enablings, right? Everything he's asked us to do, he's going to give us the power to do. And we also need to remember what he says in, we're going to look at it in just a minute here, so I'm not going to go there now, but John 15, verses 4 and 5. Now, that's where Jesus says, without me, you can do what? Nothing. So when we say, I can't do that, God, you're not fair to expect me to, but God's saying, wait a minute, I don't expect you to do it by yourself. I've told you flat out, without me, you can do nothing. Don't try to do it by yourself. You need to be abiding in me like that same verse talks about. Again, we're going to read that in a minute. That's why I'm not looking at it right now. Tempted to get ahead of myself here. What's the first thing Adam and Eve did? This isn't in the notes. I mean, yeah, it's not on the sheet here. So if you want to take notes right now, you may be better. What's the first thing Adam and Eve did after they sinned? They hid from God. Okay? Actually, they did the fig leaf thing. That's just another part, another way of hiding. And in Revelation 6, last part of the chapter there, it talks about people calling for the rocks and mountains, you know, at the very end, calling for the rocks and mountains to do what? Hide them from who? From God. And everywhere in between these two events, people have been trying to hide from God. And if you're honest, like I have to admit this myself, there's something in me that wants to hide from God, just, you know, or at least keep him over there a little ways. And if we allow that to win out, we'll be hiding from God. And we'll be saying, God, you're not fair to expect me to do this. And God's like, no, but if we get together on it, you can. Okay? If you've been hiding from God, stop. Okay, start abiding with him. And because it kind of rhymes, just throw out the question, are you hiding or are you abiding? Oh, let's go back to the quote. Okay, so we're making a list here. These are Satan's accusations. Number one, God's not fair. Reading on, it says he criticized God's plan of government, declaring the divine law to be what? Arbitrary. What does it mean to be arbitrary? Now, I have to confess, when I first read this quote, I thought, oh, that's a good quote, but I didn't save it, right? And so later on, I went, but you know, I can find that quote so I can have it to use, like we're doing tonight, or this evening. I guess it's not night quite yet. and so I remember the word arbitrary was in there, and so I just put arbitrary in the search. And you know what came up? A whole bunch of stuff about parents being arbitrary with their children. Okay? You know, all of us have been kids once. Has anybody ever told you, do it because I said so? That's being arbitrary. Okay, they're not supplying any reason for doing it. Now, having been a parent, I understand that there's certain situations where you don't have time to explain it, and they just need to do what you're asking them to do. But then it's important that you come back later and explain it to them. Say, here's the reason why we're doing this. And this is one of the things that Satan was accusing God of, that God was being arbitrary. And when we're arbitrary with our kids, you know, parents stand in the place of God for their children, we're teaching them that God is arbitrary. We need to be careful not to do this. A friend of mine shared something with me years ago. I remember reacting to it at the time. I didn't know why. Now I know exactly why, based on what we've just been talking about. And what he said was, you know, God is all-wise and all-powerful, and as the creator, he could have created the universe and the world, you know, any way he wanted to, but he chose this particular way, and he set up his laws and everything to work, you know, this particular way, and we would be wise to cooperate with what his plan is. And the problem with that is it sounds good, but at its root is God is arbitrary. Because it starts out with the basis that God could have chosen several different options, but he chose this one. That's being arbitrary. The reality is, and this could be a whole study in itself, and I'm not going to go there for the sake of time, but in the same way that there's just these two groups, there's only two ways. And we're going to explore that some more later. But there's only two ways. And basically, it's a way of an other-loving, other-centered focus or a selfish, self-centered focus for the basis for life. And we just have to look around us and see the results of the selfish, self-centered focus. And know that that doesn't work. Well, God being able to see the end from the beginning, he for sure knew that a long time ago. And so rather than setting up the universe on that basis, he set it up on love. And I'm glad he did, because that's really the only way it works. Because he knew the other way wouldn't work. So he's not being arbitrary at all, because there's really those two options. There was multiple options and he arbitrarily chose one, then yeah. But that's what the idea Satan's trying to throw out there. God isn't arbitrary. Chose the only option that was worth choosing. Well, let's back up there to the ellipse. Satan insisted that God had not dealt with him justly. He criticized God's plan of government. He declared the divine law to be arbitrary, detrimental to the interests of the heavenly universe, and in need of change. And this is a key one. Satan saying, you know, while Lucifer, who was at the time, saying, you know, we need to make some changes around here. And notice what the rest of the quote says. The questions to be answered were, is God's law imperfect, in need of being amended or abrogated? Abrogated means like done away with. Or is it immutable? In other words, is God's law already perfect and in no need of change? Is God's government stable, or does it need changes? Not only before those living in the city of God, but before the inhabitants of all the heavenly universe were these questions to be answered. Okay, each of us individually needs to answer these own questions in our own mind, in our own way, and become settled in that. Let's turn to Proverbs 1, verse 7. I want to look at another one of Satan's principles. Proverbs chapter 1, verse 7. This is a real interesting verse. We'll probably look at this again before we're done here this weekend. It says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools do what? Despise. That's a pretty strong word. Fools despise wisdom and what?
Instruction.
Does anybody have a different version with a different word there for instruction? Okay, what tipped me off to this is one of my main Bible study methods is I try to read the passage I'm studying in every version I can get a hold of. Frequently, another version will just give it a little bit different slant, and sometimes you have to go and check out and make sure that slant's valid with some of these newer translations, but every once in a while you'll come across a jewel like what I'm going to share with you here. This one version I was reading, instead of saying instruction, it said self-control. Fools despise wisdom and self-control. And I thought, well, that makes sense. Self-control is one of the fruits of the Spirit, so that kind of fits. But I still got curious about it, and so I looked the word up, what the Hebrew word means. And the Hebrew word for instruction means like training and discipline. And with the idea of self-control and restraint. And I think the easiest way I know how to illustrate this, even though I don't think it's the best illustration, I just can't think of a better one yet. Picture the difference between a trained dog and an untrained dog that gets loose at a garden wedding. Okay, so here's the garden all set up. The wedding hasn't quite started yet, but everything's getting set up, and the dog gets loose. And this is a decent-sized dog, and it's running loose, playing catch me if you can. And he's having a great time, right? But he's causing all sorts of problems, you know, knocking stuff over, bumping into people, and so on and on. Contrast that with a trained dog that gets loose in the same situation. Okay, he would like to go run, play, catch me if he can too. But he restrains himself from doing that because of his training. And when the master gives him the signal, he comes obediently comes over and he doesn't cause any trouble as a result. Okay, put this together with what the serpent told Eve at the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Said, if you eat this fruit, you will what? Your eyes will be open and you'll become wise like God. And you'll know what? What's good and evil? What's right and wrong? What's good and bad? What's the implication there? Yeah, you don't need God to tell you what to do anymore. You eat this fruit, you can decide for yourself. You can do what you want. Guess what? We like that idea really well. Do whatever you want. Don't restrain yourself. Run loose. Play catch me if you can, if you want to. Cause problems, that's the other person's fault. Remember, Satan stands for a selfish, self-centered focus. Too bad about y'all. Okay, God, on the other hand, taking a loving, other-centered focus. And together with this, I want you to think about the Ten Commandments. Okay, most of them start out with what three words? Thou shalt not. The main idea here is restrain yourself from doing these things because they're going to be hurtful to others. Okay, don't steal. Restrain yourself from stealing, because it's going to hurt other people, and so on down the list. And Satan says, nah, don't worry about that restraint. Too bad for them. Do what you want to do. doing, saying, eating, things that we shouldn't, okay, have caused a lot of the misery in this world today. And I'll just let your imagination and thoughts run on that one. I don't think I even need to explain. People who don't restrain themselves get into trouble. You know, eat stuff that's not good for you, you're going to have health issues. Say things that's not good, you're going to get into trouble. So on. Now, just one other idea I want to share with this, all of this here up to this point. Just gives you a witnessing opportunity, I don't know. In the current culture, okay, there's been a lot of movies and interest lately in the old comic book characters and so on. And the basic plot for all of these is there's these super beings with superpowers. And some of them use their superpowers for good, and some of them use their superpowers for bad, and the whole plot of the story is the conflict between the two. Well, that's really the whole great controversy played out right there. Okay, angels are super beings with superpowers. But let's bring this down to home. Compared to all the other inhabitants of planet Earth, humans are super beings with superpowers. And we could make a list real easily. I'm just going to focus on one, and that's the power of speech. Okay, other animals and such communicate, birds and such communicate, but they don't have anything close to what we can do. We have the power of speech. It's a superpower. And we can use that power for either good or for bad. And several of the Bible writers talks about that. I'm thinking of what James says right now. We can use the power of speech to build people up, or we can use the power of speech to tear people down. And God wanted to bless us with these superpowers. But in so doing, he knew there was the possibility of us using them in a bad way. And so in the Ten Commandments, he's saying, restrain yourself. Restrain yourself from using your powers in a bad way. Use them to bless people instead. And the choice is ours. And that's one of Satan's key values. You don't have to worry about restraining yourself. Let the other people worry about themselves. You just take care of yourself. Do what works for you. And pretty much the whole world is bought into that. Embraced Satan's values. Yeah, we need to be careful that we don't, so that we don't end up like the foolish virgins, thinking we're heading for the kingdom, when actually we're in the group that's worshiping the beast and receive the mark. Let's look at one other verse, kind of in connection with all this. Nahum chapter 1, verse 9. This verse explains a lot to me. Nahum, little book tucked away in the last part of the Old Testament. Nahum chapter 1, verse 9. Nahum is right after Micah and just before Habakkuk, if that helps anybody. Give you a minute to find it there. Got your own Bible, would strongly recommend you underline it. Learn where this verse is at, because this answers a lot of questions and tells us a lot about God and his character, what he's all about. Nahum chapter 1, verse 9 says, "What do you conspire against the Lord? He will do what? Make an utter end," like a complete end. And what's the last phrase? Affliction will not what? Rise up the second time. What does that mean to you? I'll just put it in my words. I've had a little more time to think about it. It's not really fair. I expect you to come up with something really profound all of a sudden. But after this experiment with sin that demons and humans have been doing for the last 6,000 or so years, right? After this is done, that's it. No more. Forever. For the rest of eternity. Okay? Why? Okay, yeah, right, but why would God say it's not going to happen again?
Because he's a just God. Because he destroys the author of sin.
Yeah.
The demonstration of Satan's ways is going to cure us of it. We're not going to want to go back to it.
Yeah, a lot of implications here. Okay, I think I have time. I'm going to go ahead and do something else. I didn't really plan to, but I felt impressed this afternoon to include it, and I think we're doing all right. Keep this verse in mind. Turn to Ezekiel chapter 28. Ezekiel chapter 28. We're looking for verses 14 and 15. Ezekiel 28, verse 14 says, "You were what? The anointed cherub." Who's this talking about? I was talking about Lucifer, yeah, who became Satan, but this is when he was still Lucifer. He was the anointed cherub who covers, the covering cherub. What does that mean? What is that, the covering cherub? What does that signify? Okay, remember the sanctuary? It's kind of a model of the sanctuary in heaven, the sanctuary on earth here. And in the most holy place was the Ark of the Covenant. On top of the ark was what? The mercy seat. What did that represent? God's throne. And over God's throne, there were what? The two covering cherubs. Okay, Lucifer once was one of these covering cherubs. Okay, the closest angels to God. "You were the anointed cherub who covers. I established you. You were on the holy mountain with God and walked back and forth in the midst of the fiery stones." And verse 15 is the key verse for us here. It says, "You were what? Perfect in your ways from the day you were what? Created till iniquity was found in you." Now that's a real interesting verse. We're not told a whole lot, but we are told this much. Lucifer was created, and until iniquity was found in him, he was what? Perfect. And so picture the universe during this time, from the creation of the angels until Lucifer sinned. What was the universe like during that time? Yeah, it was perfect. Let me ask a question, though. Was the universe secure during that time? Yeah, you're catching on, huh? Was the universe secured in that time?
It was secure because God was allowing free choice with Lucifer, but it was secure before, when Lucifer was perfect, before iniquity was found in him.
Okay, let's look at this from God's perspective. Okay, God knows the end from the beginning. He knows what's going to happen. And I think this time is very key to the whole great controversy. There was a time when the universe was perfect. Everything was in harmony. But was the universe secure? No. Because there was always the possibility that one of these angels or intelligent beings, I'll just put it that way, one of these intelligent beings would exercise their free choice and choose not to go God's way. And from history and the Bible, we know Lucifer was the one that started all of that. Okay, in order for the universe to be secure, we're jumping now clear to the end time. Okay, affliction will not rise up the second time. Here's these few thousand years that sin is allowed to run its course. After this, no more for the rest of eternity. Okay, will the universe be secure then? Yes. What makes the universe secure then? We've mentioned some of it here already. I'm going to reword it a little bit, hopefully to click your thinking on some stuff. The only way for the universe to be secure is for every intelligent being that has the power of choice to be completely settled in that choice, one way or the other. And so sin has been allowed to run its course so that everybody, you know, humans and angels, and the people on the other worlds who we know very little about, can become settled in that choice, one way or the other. And then at the end of it, everybody's taken their sides, and then the universe will be secure. And so that's God's ultimate goal. But this has to happen in order for us to have that security. It's not comfortable going through. Not fun at all. Let me illustrate this a little bit more. Picture us in this time here. We're one of the angels. And everything's perfect and harmonious. And we think it's the way it's going to be forever. But then we start hearing these rumblings. Right? These different accusations that Lucifer is starting to bring out. And he's doing it in a very crafty way. And from the Bible here, we know he managed to deceive a whole third of the angels. But we're hearing these rumblings. And they get louder and louder. And guess what? We have to choose which side we're going to be on. And as we're told there in Revelation 12, came a time when there was war in heaven. Okay, we don't like the idea of war in heaven. But it was necessary. Because that war forced everybody to choose one way or the other. Which side are they going to be on? Because the only way it can be secure if all the intelligent beings are completely settled in their thinking and in their choice. And I use that word settled because it's a good descriptive word of what needs to happen. But we're told, and that word is used to describe the ceiling. Those who are familiar with that quote. The ceiling is this settling into the truth so that you cannot be moved. That's what's happening now. Okay, and we each need to make our choice. Are we going to embrace God's values of worrying about the other guy first, living to benefit and bless others? Or are we going to embrace Satan's values? I'm just looking out for myself and too bad about y'all. I mean, I'm putting it in really simple terms. It gets way more complicated than that because Satan's very deceptive. And he wants to make us think that we're doing things God's way when we're really doing stuff his way. And that's one of the reasons Jesus gave us the parable of the 10 virgins. So that we would understand that there's people who are going to be totally deceived at the end and miss out as a result. Turn to 1 Corinthians 15:58. Last verse in 1 Corinthians 15. This verse kind of packages everything I've been sharing here the last little bit. It says, therefore, my beloved brethren, be what? Steadfast. Be settled. I'm sure all of us have probably gone through, or at least earlier in our Christian experience, a time where we were kind of going back and forth. Maybe daily going back and forth. Okay, sometimes we'd be living for God and other times we wouldn't, and just kind of going back and forth. And I remember at one point in my life when I was doing that and I just thinking, you know, ran across this steadfast idea. You know, I really need to be steadfast. And God's like, yeah, that's probably my goal for you. Therefore, my beloved, be steadfast, immovable. Okay, settled so you cannot be moved. always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. And that's a really good verse. It's God's goal for us. Notice we're abounding in the work of the Lord, which is to do what? Benefit and bless others. Okay, we're going back to the study guide now. Pick it up with number 6. Let's look at the next quotation. This is Education, page 154. It says, unselfishness, the principle of whose kingdom? God's kingdom. Okay, so the principle of God's kingdom is unselfish love. We've been talking about that already. Unselfishness, the principle of God's kingdom is the principle that Satan hates. Okay, its very existence he denies. Okay, he's been trying to prove that God's really been acting selfishly. Well, Jesus disproved all of that when he came on the cross. But this kind of just says it straight out. What's going on here? Unselfishness. The principle of God's kingdom is the principle that Satan hates. Its very existence he denies. From the beginning of the great controversy, he has endeavored to prove God's principles of action to be selfish, and he deals the same way with all who serve God. He's doing the same thing with us. Trying to deceive us into thinking we're selfish, and there's no other way than selfishness. It's a lie. And notice that last sentence there, to disprove Satan's claim is the work of Christ and who else? All who bear his name. You calling yourself a Christian? Good. You're one of those who bear his name. And our work is to do what? Disprove Satan's claims. Okay, remember we had kind of a list here. God's not fair. God's arbitrary. God needs to change. You don't need to restrain yourself. Okay? Our work is to disprove those claims. And can we disprove them if we're embracing any one of them? No. That's why we need to get rid of all the sin in our life. But we can't do that, right? Because Jesus said, without me, you can do nothing. Turn to John 15. I'm getting ahead of myself, huh? John 15, verses 4 and 5. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. Okay, can't do it by yourself. Can only do it as you're abiding in Jesus. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him does what? Bears much fruit. Without me, you can do nothing. What does fruit represent? It says if we're connected to Jesus, if he's abiding in us and we're abiding in him, we're going to bear fruit. What does that mean? God's values? Yeah, for sure. It's all about God's values. Souls figure into it, but there's more than that. I'm going to save a whole lot of time here, and let's just picture a plant, just a generic plant. This is ground level. Below the ground, plants have what? Roots. Above ground, plants have what? Branches. I'm going to say stems and branches. Now, on the stems and branches are? Leaves, and then flowers that turn into fruit. Okay, just going to pick those four categories, just trying to keep it real simple here. Roots, stems and branches, leaves and fruit. What do the roots do for the plant? Soak up soil nutrients and what? Water. What else? Provide a framework. Okay, let's think like survivalists here just a little bit. If we were to cut the roots off, what's going to happen to the plant? It's going to fall over and die. Okay, roots are essential for the survival of the plant. Stems and branches, what do they do for the plant? Okay, they have vascular tissue, which transports the water and nutrients and food all around so everybody has what they need. They also hold the leaves out in the sunlight so they can do what they need to do. Okay? Again, if we were to cut the stems and branches off the plant, what's going to happen? It's going to fall over and die. Like the roots, the stems and branches are essential for the survival of the plant. Doesn't work without it. Leaves, what do the leaves do? Photosynthesis, I heard somebody say that. It's that big word that means taking carbon dioxide and water and using sunlight energy to convert it into sugar, which provides food for the whole plant. And also, on the underside of the leaves are a little opening called stomata. We don't think of plants as breathing, but they do have a gas exchange, and that's where the gas exchange happens, through those little openings. And so let's say we pick all the leaves off the plant. It's going to try to grow new ones, but we keep picking them off. What's going to happen? Plant's going to die. Like the roots, like the stems and branches, leaves are essential for the survival of the plant. That brings us to fruit. What does fruit do? For the plant it's growing on. Fruit doesn't do anything for the plant it's growing on. The plant would grow just fine without fruit. Remember a fig tree that Jesus ran into one day, didn't have any fruit. Okay? So if fruit doesn't do anything for the plant that it's growing on, why did Jesus choose fruit to represent the result of us being connected to Him? I heard somebody say what? So I'm going to say that question again. If fruit doesn't do anything for the plant it's growing on, why did Jesus choose fruit to illustrate the result of us being connected with Him? Because fruit is something the plant doesn't do for itself. Fruit is something the plant does for others. Okay, maybe it's the next generation. Maybe it's a bird or animal that comes along and eats it. Even if it falls to the ground and rots, it's going to enrich the soil. And Jesus said if we're connected to Him, we're going to do what? We're going to bear much fruit. In other words, we're going to live to benefit and bless others. That's God's way. Pardon? In God's sight, and ours too. Yeah. There's that one parable in Luke 6, I think. Guy had a fig tree in his garden and it wasn't producing any fruit. He said, take it out. Why is it using up space? So, what does this mean? Okay, this is like the total opposite of Satan's values. See, God's values are all about benefiting and blessing others. And He doesn't expect us to do it on our own. He says you can only do it as you're connected to Me. Now let me give a modern illustration for that. God wants us to be like a garden hose. What's the purpose of a garden hose? To take water from somewhere where it isn't to somewhere it needs to be. I have a garden hose here. Can I expect that garden hose to squirt water? It can only squirt water how? It's connected to the faucet and the faucet's turned on. That represents our relationship with God. Okay? Just as we can't bear fruit on our own, the hose can't produce water on its own. And the water represents the blessings that God wants to use us as a channel to share with the rest of the world. So trouble is there's one of these valves on the other end. That's our selfishness valve. And too often we're saying, no, I'm going to hang on to all those blessings. But what happens to the water sitting in the hose, out in the lawn, in the hot summer sun? It gets stagnant real fast. I think we've all at one point in our existence gone and turned the faucet on and didn't let it all clear out and took a mouthful of stagnant water. And it's so gross. And it's the same way. Okay, the only way we can be full of fresh, clear blessings is to let it flow. But if you're going to let it flow, you have to be connected to God, and you have to, you know, that connection has to be a working connection. Without me, you can do nothing, Jesus says. Okay, don't try to produce fruit on your own. Okay? Focus on abiding in Him, being connected to Him. And the rest of this stuff will take care of itself. Let it flow. Let's go way back to the beginning of the study here. Two groups that we found in the third angel's message. The first group was those who worshiped the beast in his image and received the mark. Oh, let's talk about the mark here really quick. I have a hard time, this is just illustration here, please. I have a hard time finding t-shirts that don't have something written on them. Okay? I don't want to be a billboard. Some people don't care. But what do they typically write on the t-shirts? Okay, maybe a brand. What else? Sports team, maybe? I'm going to go with a sports team because that's easy to illustrate. Okay, why would you buy a t-shirt that had one sports team's name on it, but not buy another t-shirt that had a different sports team's name on it? Yeah, because this is your team. Okay, you choose to identify with this team and you're willing to wear its mark because you choose to identify with it. Now, don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying there's anything wrong about having stuff written on your t-shirt. Okay, I'm just an illustration. But the mark of the beast means we're willing to wear the mark. We're willing to identify with the beast and his values, which are ultimately Satan's values. That's what the mark of the beast is all about. We'll talk more about that tomorrow morning. Okay, so there's this one group that are worshiping the beast and receiving the mark. And the other group, how are they described? Those who keep the commandments and have what?
Faith.
The faith of Jesus. Okay, that literally means Jesus' faith. The same type of faith that Jesus had. I want to end talking about that a little bit more. This is point number 7 in your study guide there. I just listed Psalm 22 and Isaiah 53 because those are like two whole chapters that do this. And they're, you know, literally hundreds of prophecies in the Bible about what Jesus would say and do and be, you know, when he came the first time. And we call those messianic prophecies. Some of you are familiar with that term. So anyway, there's all these hundreds of messianic prophecies, and Psalm 22 and Isaiah 53 are just examples of that, where you have like a whole chapter rather than just a verse kind of off by itself somewhere. And these all of these messianic prophecies, you know, just think of the different times when Jesus told the disciples, you know, yeah, but let's do it this way to fulfill the prophecies, right? And so Jesus in his earth life was literally fulfilling the prophecies. And look at the next quote here. Number 13. Oh, I messed up with the numbering here. Sorry. It's the next quote. It just has a 13 on it instead of 9 like it should be. So Desire of Ages, page 690. says Jesus' humanity shrunk from the last crowning sacrifice. What does that tell you? You know, in his humanity, he didn't want to go through it, right? He didn't like what he knew was going to happen. How did he know what was going to happen? Because of the messianic prophecies that he'd been studying his whole life. I recently read the chapter in Desire of Ages about when Jesus went to the temple at 12 years old. And it just, with this in mind, it just really struck me that, like, it was saying, like, you know, as he was watching the different ceremonies that were happening in the temple and in connection with that first feast that he went to, he was seeing himself and his own, he, you know, this is like a message he put in there, you know, hundreds of years before. And now as a child, he's learning the lessons that he put into that ceremony and understanding more fully what his mission was all about. I just found that fascinating. And so he's been studying these prophecies. He knows what's going to happen to him. And when was the great test in his life? A lot of times we're tempted to think it was the cross, but it was really in the Garden of Gethsemane, right? And what was his prayer there? It's Matthew 26, verse 39. But I think most of you know this by heart. You know, yeah, and just, he says, you know, Father, if it's possible, is there any other way? See, in his humanity, he wasn't excited about doing what he's going to go do. But then he says, nevertheless, not my will, but your will. Okay, I think that's the most clear statement of the faith of Jesus that we have. Now, here's something that he doesn't want to go through, but he's going to go through it because he knows that's God's will. And we're told elsewhere, you know, for the joy that was set before him, he knew what the end was going to turn out to be too. God told him that. And that, you know, by so doing, he was going to save many people, including all of us, hopefully. Yeah, it would be worth it. Look at the next quote here. It's Ministry of Healing. Page 479, that's the exact same wording in Desire of Ages, page 224, 225. And I think this is one we really need to wrap our heads around. It says, God never leads his children otherwise than they would choose to be led if they could see the end from the beginning and discern the glory of the purpose which they are fulfilling as co-workers with him. Read that again. So God never leads his children otherwise than they would choose to be led if they could see the end from the beginning and discern the glory of the purpose which they are fulfilling as co-workers with him. In other words, if we could see the end from the beginning the way God can see the end from the beginning, we would choose to have God lead us the exact same way he's leading us. And when you're going into a trial, remember that quote. Okay, remember that quote. That you would choose to be led that same way. You're like, here it's coming. This isn't going to be fun. But you recognize God leading you. And then you would choose to be led that same way if you could see the end from the beginning like God can see the end from the beginning and understand the purpose, why he's doing what he's doing. Okay, that's what Jesus was doing back there in the Garden of Gethsemane. He was choosing God's way rather than reacting to his human, no, I don't want to do this. This isn't going to be fun. It's going to be very uncomfortable. Okay, the faith of Jesus, choosing to be led the exact same way that God leads us, trusting his wisdom, his foreknowledge, and that he really knows what's best. And with that in mind, Amos 3, verse 7, good Adventist verse from way back. Anybody have it memorized? It says, surely the Lord God will do nothing except he does what? Reveals his secrets to who? His servants. The prophets. Okay, surely the Lord God will do nothing except he reveals his secrets to his servants, the prophets. And so God has revealed what's going to happen to who? The prophets. And what did they do? They wrote it in here. That's where all the messianic prophecies were. That's how Jesus knew what was going to happen to him. Brothers and sisters, in the same way, in the exact same way, we've been given the end time prophecies. And in the same way that Jesus lived out the messianic prophecies during his lifetime, we've been given these end time prophecies so that we can live out these prophecies here in the end times. And that's already started. Talk about that tomorrow more. Okay, we need to be living out these prophecies, just like Jesus was living out these prophecies. A lot of times we get other ideas. No, God, you need to change stuff. I don't like what's going to happen. I remember somebody telling me when I was a kid, I was asking them about the end time prophecies a little bit, and they're like, no, we don't want to talk about those. Those are too scary. We need to study these prophecies so that we can know what we're supposed to do. Just like Jesus studied them so he knew what to do. Yeah, they're scary. Yeah, they don't look like they're going to be fun. But are we going to choose? I mean, that's the way God has said he's going to lead us. Are we going to choose that? Are we going to choose to go our own way? No, I embrace Satan's values. No, I'm not going to do it God's way. God needs to change stuff. Let me share an experience with you. I'm going to keep this real generic here. I was working at an Adventist institution, and I had gone to the office. I needed to do some business at the office. And, those of you who worked in institutions, you need to go to the office from time to time, and you're sitting there waiting for your turn to talk to them. And so I'm standing in line. There's somebody in front of me, and another coworker comes in, and they're standing there too, and so we're talking a little bit as we're waiting our turn. And my coworker knows me, as you will this after this weekend, that I'm into wilderness survival in preparation for the final end times. And my coworker said, when the time comes to flee to the mountains, God's going to have to do something different for me because he knows I'm such a city person that I couldn't handle that. And I remember reacting to that at the time. Again, I didn't know exactly why. Now I know exactly why. Because that is not an expression of the faith of Jesus. Okay? That's what Satan was saying. God, you need to change. You need to do something else different for me. Okay, having the faith of Jesus means being willing to follow God and his plan for us. Be willing to be led the same way that we would choose to be led if we could see the end from the beginning and understand God's purpose like he can. But we're trusting his wisdom. And the last quote there says, as we near the close of this world's history, this is from Testimonies to Ministers 1:16. As we near the close of this world's history, the prophecies relating the last days especially demand our study. So we're going to do some more of that tomorrow. Now let's back up one quote here. Let's just share this one more time, or read this one more time in closing. It says, God never leads his children otherwise than they would choose to be led if they could see the end from the beginning and discern the glory of the purpose which they are fulfilling as co-workers with him. That's the faith of Jesus. And we are going to need to have the faith of Jesus in order to make it through the end. I mean, that's just kind of the context of the third angel's message there. And I know that's a lot to wrap your head around, but I would challenge you to struggle with these things if you need to. Become settled so that you cannot be moved. And be willing to have the same kind of faith that Jesus had. To trust God and His wisdom. And even though I don't necessarily like what I see coming in the prophecies, I'm still going to align myself with that, prepare myself for that, just as Jesus prepared himself for what he was to go through. Let's pray. Father, thank you for revealing all these things in your word. May we allow your Holy Spirit to teach them to us and let them sink deep into our hearts so that we can have the faith of Jesus and be able to make it through the end. May we be willing to do some heart searching. Make sure that we're not embracing any of Satan's values so that we don't end up like the foolish virgins. May we spend the time that we need to study the prophecies and learn how to live according to them. Prepare ourselves for all these things. Because as we look around the world, we know what's happening soon. And as the other quote says, we're already years behind. So we got a lot to do in a short time. I pray that you'll continue to bless this program this weekend. So we study these things, talk about them, and learn how to apply them in a practical way. And most of all, thank you, Jesus, for coming and dying for us to make this all possible. So I pray this in your name. Amen. She made up an answer key as we were going through the study. So if any of you missed any of the blanks, just go talk to her and she'll help you out with that.